Thank you, worship team, for leading us this morning in worship. Good morning. It's good to be with you all. My name is Michael Turtelot, and I'm the discipleship and worship pastor here. And this morning, we're going to be picking up our little summer mini-series in Romans 8 with verse 18 of Romans 8. And you can find our passage on page 888 in one of the Pew Bibles if you didn't bring one with you. And before I get started, though, during the greeting time, I noticed that Bethel is here with us. Sorry, Bethel, hopefully you don't mind me pointing you out, but Bethel was, I think, the first secretary we ever had in the church office. Okay, well, she was the secretary of my childhood, at least, in the church office, and so it's good to see you, Bethel, and have you here with us. So yes, Romans 8, and we'll pick it up in verse 18. While you're turning there, I'd like to begin, though, with a story. And it begins with a woman waking up in the middle of the night with some cramps, suffering from cramps. And at first they weren't too bad. In fact, she could kind of tell, you know how sometimes you wake up and you realize, oh, something's been happening while I'm sleeping. That was sort of how they started. So they're pretty mild at first, but they sort of gradually became worse to the point where they became fairly uncomfortable. And so she did all the kinds of things that you do when you have cramps. You get some water and eat a banana and, you know, massage the affected areas and rest and, you know, all that. And so she waited to see if they would subside and get any better, but they didn't. They progressively got worse to the point where she eventually woke up her husband and kind of let him know what was going on, and they started discussing, okay, well, do you need to, like, go into the hospital or something like that? And that discussion became moot as they kept on getting worse, and it became clear they needed to get some help. And so they got out of bed and they got to the hospital as quickly as they could. Upon getting to the hospital, they were immediately brought into their own private room, and there was a team of doctors and nurses that started hooking her up to things and monitoring her and checking her out. And yet the odd thing was that for all their activity and all the monitoring they seemed to be doing for this woman, they didn't seem all that concerned with kind of helping her with her actual symptoms, which is bad, because by this point, each time she was hit with a cramp, it was her whole body was being racked with these incredibly painful cramps that were causing her to cry out in pain, and they just got worse and worse and worse until it got to the point where the woman, she simply thought, I'm going to die. I'm going to die from this. My body can't keep on. You can't keep on going like this. It's going to give in. It's going to break. I can't do this. And so finally, as her strength was giving out and the most severe convulsion of all came upon her after hours of struggle and pain, she gave birth to a beautiful baby boy. You probably saw where I was going with that story, but it still illustrates the point. That hypothetical yet true story illustrates a point, which is that not all pain in life means that there's something going wrong. Not all pain means there's something going wrong. Sometimes it actually means something good is coming. Something good is happening. And childbirth isn't the only place we can see this. We're in the Olympic season. The Olympics are in progress. And every one of those athletes knows that there are, broadly speaking, two types of pain. There's the pain of injury, which is a pain that says there's something has gone wrong. But then there's also the pain that accompanies growth. And that idea is enshrined in perhaps the most famous maxim from athletics that there is, which is no pain, no gain. Yeah, no pain, no gain, which speaks to the physical reality that to build muscle, you actually have to break your muscle down so that it can grow back stronger, and that's painful. But this reality goes well beyond that, even. If you want to grow in any area of your life, you can expect that process to include some discomfort, to involve some discomfort. You want to learn to write? You must put in tedious hours of studying language and storytelling methods. You got to put in tedious hours of reading good writers so that you can emulate them. You want to learn to play an instrument? You must put in tedious hours of practice. And so it is with all growth in the human life, including within our spiritual lives. James says it this way in the book of James, "Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. And then earlier in Romans, Paul says it like this. Not only that, but again, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. So both James and Paul tell us to rejoice when we encounter hardships, when we encounter trials, not because it feels good, because of course it doesn't, but because it's producing something good. That for the Christian, for the Christ follower, suffering is producing something good. And understanding this has the power to transform our relationship to suffering and difficulty, changing those uncomfortable realities from forces of destruction to agents of renewal. And this is what Paul is going to argue for in our passage this morning. So let's pray, and then we'll look at it together. Father, we are thankful that you use even suffering for good in our lives. And yet, once again, I just confess, though, that that is a difficult reality for us to come to terms with. When we see the suffering around us in the world, when we see the suffering in our own lives, and so often it's difficult to see how this suffering can lead to anything good. And so we just confess that that's hard for us to see sometimes, and yet you promise to use everything for our good, including our suffering here. And so I just ask again this morning that you would give us the eyes to see and the ears to hear what the Spirit wants to say to us on this matter this morning. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's dive right in with verse 18 from Romans 8, which reads, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us." So here Paul hints at this idea of suffering producing something good simply by setting up the contrast between the current sufferings that we undergo here and this future coming glory that's going to be revealed. Now last week, Pastor Grant touched on suffering briefly, but I want to spend a little bit more time fleshing out what I think Paul means here when he says suffering. So the passage last week, which is where he sort of starts talking about suffering, dealt with the reality that even though followers of Christ are filled with his Spirit, we still have this struggle with our flesh, with sin within us. And so there's this struggle between the Holy Spirit and our flesh. And verse 13 kind of lays that out. And then in verse 17, Paul tells us that Christ followers are heirs of God, but he says, provided that we share in his sufferings, in Christ's sufferings, so that we may eventually share in his glory. So this suffering that Paul is talking about has something to do with the struggle between the Spirit and our flesh. It's something that we share in common with Jesus. So Jesus also experienced it and will eventually result in glory. So taking all that into account, here's what I think Paul is talking about, what he means. I think he's talking about the suffering that comes with wrestling with the brokenness of ourselves and the brokenness of the world around us. He's just talking about, pretty generally, I would say, he's talking about the suffering that comes as we wrestle with sin in us and around us. There's a lot of suffering, both internal and external, that accompanies struggle with sin. As Christ followers, or all Christ followers, know the feeling of being tempted by sin, the struggle and the strain it is to resist temptation, and that sickening feeling when resistance fails and we give in. Because the reality is that despite the incredible fact that where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more, that's incredible, and we praise God for that, and yet struggling with and succumbing to sin is still difficult and painful and discouraging for Christians, despite the fact that grace covers it all. Now, so that's kind of part one. That has to do with the struggle between the Spirit and our flesh. Part two, I said, is it something we share in common with Jesus? And so maybe you're thinking, well, but Jesus never sinned. So how can this suffering that we share with him be suffering associated with struggling with sin if he never sinned? And I would say that just because Jesus didn't sin doesn't mean he didn't wrestle with sin. Doesn't mean he didn't wrestle with sin. In fact, Hebrews 4:15 says that Jesus was in every respect tempted as we are, yet without sin. So yes, he didn't sin, but he did wrestle against it. In fact, C.S. Lewis would argue that Jesus has actually struggled with sin more than any other human being ever has. He says this in Mere Christianity: "A man who gives into temptation after 5 minutes simply does not know what it would have been like an hour later. Christ, because he was the only man who never yielded to temptation, is only the only man who knows to the full what temptation means." And so Jesus, because he was the only one who, because when you give in to temptation, you do get relief from the temptation, at least briefly until it comes back. But Jesus never gave in. Never gave in, and so he experienced the full intensity of being tempted by sin. So internally, we share the struggle against sin with Jesus, and externally, we do as well, simply because if you seek to live like Jesus, you will find yourself at odds with the world in various ways. There may be opportunities for self-advancement that you have to forego because of your integrity. There may be, you will almost certainly give more of yourself than you get from others in return as you seek to be selflessly giving like Christ was. And so on, perhaps even to the extreme where, as you follow Jesus and as they did with Jesus, you get rejected as he was, or persecuted as he was, or even lose your life as he was, simply because you won't go with the brokenness in the world around you, go along with that. And so sin is still in us, sin is still around us, and as Christ followers, though, we are called to wage war against it. Called to wage war against it. And we're called to wage war with the weapons of grace and truth. But with that war comes suffering. With any war comes suffering. And so it is as we wrestle against sin. But coming back to verse 18, after the suffering comes glory. After the suffering comes glory. So what is Paul talking about when he talks about the glory that is to be revealed to us? Verse 19 hints at the answer to this question, saying, "For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God." So, put simply, the glory to be revealed is sons of God, the sons of God. Now remember, Paul, Grant said this last week, Paul's not using the term sons here as a way of saying women are excluded from what he's talking about. Rather, he's saying that whoever comes to Jesus, man or woman, is considered a son, and because they're considered a son, they're considered an heir. That's how you become an heir. In Paul's day, the oldest sons were the heirs of their father's estates. And so he uses the term here to make the point that every Christian inherits all that the father is and has, gets that inheritance. And so the day that glory to be revealed is basically the day when we come into our inheritance, when our identity as the sons of God is fully realized. That is the glory to come. And we'll actually talk about that more next week, what that looks like. But Paul says all of creation is longing for that day to come. All of creation is longing for the revealing of the sons of God. And he goes on in verses 20 through 21 to explain why creation is so desirous of that day. "For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God." These verses might strike you as a little confusing at first, but what Paul is doing here is he's taking us back to Eden. He's taking us back to Eden. You see, creation, like the created world around us, the animals and all that, didn't choose to disobey God. They didn't choose to disobey God. It didn't subject itself to futility willingly, in Paul's words. But rather, it was subjected to futility, actually, by virtue of God's decree. Because in Genesis 1:28, God subjected creation to Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve when he said to Adam and Eve, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth. So Adam and Eve, they did willingly subject themselves to the futility of trying to figure out good and evil on their own terms instead of trusting God's terms when they disobeyed the command not to eat from the tree in the midst of the garden, okay? So they did willingly sign up for futility. But creation, because it was under them, subjected to Adam and Eve, it was subjected to futility, not willingly, but in submission to the rulers that God had put over it. And so it was drawn into futility as well. And so this is why creation longs for the revealing of the sons of God, because that revelation means the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. In other words, what's happening here is creation has long endured the rule of some exceptionally poor masters, Adam and Eve and all their descendants. But it knows the day is coming when it will be set free, when the children of God will rule it and care for it in the way God originally intended them to. And that brings us to verses 22 through 23. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. It's not hard to see or hear the world groaning around us. It's not hard to see that the world is in upheaval and in a plethora of ways, whether it's the natural disasters of earthquake or flood or tornado or fire or hurricane, or whether it's the human disasters of war and famine and division and despair. All of creation is groaning, and we feel that groaning echoed in our own souls. Things are not right. They're not as they should be, and everyone and everything can feel it. We're racked with pain and sorrow and turmoil. We groan under the feeling that the whole thing, including our very selves, is about to break under the strain of our travails. But Paul says our groaning is the groaning of new birth. It's the groaning that precedes new birth. Our turmoil is the turmoil of labor. Our struggle with the brokenness within ourselves and in the world around us is the sign not so much of coming destruction as it is the sign of coming renewal for those who are in Christ. Paul's use of this analogy helped resolve a seeming tension for me in how the Bible talks about the end times. If you read the apocalyptic portions of Scripture, and I'm mostly thinking of Jesus' statements on what will kind of lead up to the end. The progression of events seems to go something like this. Things get worse and 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 worse till glorious new kingdom. And that's just how it happens, which always, that didn't make sense to me. How does it just get worse, worse, and worse, and then all of a sudden everything is just great? But then I realized, that's after reading Romans 8 and reflecting on it, that that's kind of like what childbirth is like. Childbirth is kind of like that. Things seem to be getting harder and harder and harder, more and more painful until baby, new life. That's how it comes about. And so I think this should change our outlook on suffering drastically. Just as the story I told in the beginning would have had a very different feel had you known it was a woman in labor from the start. Because a woman's experience of extreme contractions is drastically altered if she knows a baby is on the way, is it not? It changes it from a terrifying medical emergency to something you've expected and you've anticipated and you can look forward to with joy. Now, that doesn't make labor easy or painless, or not terrifying, but it does make it worth it. it does make it worth it. So much so that women voluntarily seek to undergo the traumas of childbirth because what it produces is so precious and so good. So what Paul's doing here is he's helping us reinterpret our suffering. He's trying to get us to reinterpret our suffering. And so this is the main idea from this morning, that the turmoil of this world is, at least in part, the type of pain that signals the coming of new life. Not necessarily the coming of destruction, but the coming of new life, which reflects the surprisingly complicated relationship that humans have toward pain. Initially, it seems like our relationship to pain is simple, right? Pain is bad, we try to avoid it, and that's the relationship to pain. But if you listen to people talk about their pain, or if you've ever gone through painful experiences yourself, it's just not quite that simple. A few of my sermons ago, I shared a part of the birth story of our oldest daughter, Faye, in which we went from a home birth to an emergency C-section due to complications with the delivery. Well, part two of that story is that after Faye was safely delivered and it seemed like the ordeal was kind of over, there was a nurse who discovered a heart murmur during her newborn screening. And so we sort of went through a round of, you know, x-rays and ultrasounds and all that to see what was going on. At first, they weren't concerned, but then after all those scans, they discovered that her pulmonary heart valve had never fully developed, and so it was really restricted, and she was kind of fine at the time, but it was going to become a problem if we didn't address it. And so, about 24 hours after she was born, she and I were in an ambulance headed up to OHSU's NICU. Thankfully, her condition was, as far as heart conditions go, was minor, and relatively easily corrected over the next coming days. But the night we were transferred, sort of before I knew that was going to be the case, after getting Faye settled into the OHSU NICU and meeting with doctors and charting the path forward and finding a hotel room up there, I remember just lying in bed with my wife Amanda, just weeping and trying to pray and not being able to find the words. It's the only time in my life I literally could not even find the first word to say in a prayer. And so our prayer that night was just tears. It was just tears. We just kind of wept and that was it. Because never had I or we felt so broken and so helpless and so afraid as we did that week. And yet, I tell you with all honesty that there's a kind of sweetness as I look back on that experience and in my memory. Now, don't hear me wrong, there's also a lot of pain, and it was traumatic, okay, so that's there too, but there's also a certain sweetness to it, because Never have I felt so held by my Heavenly Father as I did that night, lying in bed, weeping, not being able to pray. Never have I felt so comforted as the morning of Faye's heart procedure, as I'm showering the chorus to the song Good, Good Father, just kind of popped into my head as just this reminder that whatever happens today, like, I have a good, good Father. Never have I experienced the love and support of both my biological and faith families as I did in that week. And so, on the one hand, I would never want to go through that week again, experience that week again, but on the other, it's hard for me to say that I would trade those sweet experiences of getting to know God's love and care and the care of my community and all those things. I don't know that I would trade those just to escape the pain of that week. Now, I've also had other painful experiences in my life that don't have, you know, that I don't know why God took me through those things. So it's not always clear what he's doing, but that's kind of my point, is that our relationship to pain is actually complicated. It's complicated, and that complication is captured poignantly in the imagery of birth. Because the pain of childbirth is, at least in the Christian understanding, is a result of sin in the world. It's a result of the fall. That's why the pain is there. And yet, through that pain, God brings new life. God brings new life. And Paul says that this is the case with much of the suffering in the world. God is bringing about something good. It needs to be acknowledged, though, that from our perspective, not every story ends well, and that we can't see how things will work out in the end, which means that even though we might be able to see examples here and there of what Paul's claiming here, we ultimately have to take a lot of this by faith. But I would just remind you that Jesus himself says in Revelation 21:5 that he is making all things new. That's at the end of everything. He's saying, I'm making all things new. And so, for Christians, it's right that we groan under the strain of the suffering that we experience on account of our struggle with sin inside us and around us. But we shouldn't groan fearfully, as though the world were crashing down around us and all hope was lost. We groan as a woman in labor, enduring the suffering with hope and anticipation of the glorious new life the suffering will ultimately deliver. And I'll be honest, I worry that this is a part of the Christian witness that's kind of weak in our context right now. Because I hear a lot of Christians who bemoan the state of the world around them, and rightfully so, don't hear me wrong, the concerns about the world around us is not the problem. The problem is that so often those concerns seem to be voiced more in fear and despair than in hope, anticipating what God's going to do with it all. Which is really concerning because Christians are fundamentally people of hope, as we see in verses 24 through 25. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Brothers and sisters, one day, the new creation that Jesus began when he rose from the grave will be completed. And our bodies and all of creation will be redeemed completely from sin. One day, every evil will be vanquished, and we will dwell in a world of perfect goodness. One day, as Samwise Gamgee wondered, every sad thing will come untrue. One day, God's kingdom will come, and his will be done on earth, just like it's done in heaven right now. And so all the turmoil in the world must be viewed with that end in mind. While we don't know what things will look like between now and then, that day is coming. And so, we have hope. We always have hope. But we're not there yet, which is why it's hope and not sight, because we're not there yet. But it's a sure hope. It's a sure hope. Hope in the Bible is not crossing your fingers with a 50-50 expectation that what you desire will come to pass. The hope that Scripture offers is based on the promise of a God who cannot lie. And so, it's not a question of if, it's a question of when and how. It's a question of when and how. And we don't know the when and the how of it all. We might have bits and pieces, we might be able to, you know, take some guesses, but we don't know when and how God is going to bring it all together. We don't get that information, and that's an incredibly difficult position for us humans to occupy. We don't like that. We don't like not knowing when and how things are going to happen. As a pastor, I talk to a lot of people who are going through various seasons of one kind or another in which the when and the how are not clear. It's gotten to the point where I'm convinced that God very intentionally places his children in seasons where the answers we want so bad are not clear, and then he lets us sit there for a little while. And you may wonder, well, why would God do that? That sounds cruel. Well, I would say he does it to break us of our trust in ourselves, putting our trust in ourselves or putting our trust in other faulty places, and to deepen our trust in him. When we have a clear path and a clear timeline, we feel some modicum of control over our lives and circumstances. When the path forward is unclear and the time frame ambiguous, we're forced to ask the fundamental question, do I really trust God? Do I really believe that God even exists? Do I actually trust that he cares for me? Do I actually believe that he's at work in the world for my good and for the good of the world at large? It's easy to say you believe those things when you're healthy, wealthy, and comfortable. It's only when our self-sufficiency is undermined and our utter dependency is exposed that that belief is truly tested. One of the biggest lessons Amanda and I learned through the ordeal of having Faye was that Faye is not ours. Faye is not ours. Our girls are not ours. We don't own them. We realized we had no ability to preserve her life. There was nothing we could do to prevent her from miscarrying or from having a birth defect. Those things were utterly up to the discretion of God. So the big question was, do we trust him? And I hope you realize that the same could be said for you and for all that you love. There's nothing you can do to prevent a freak accident or a terminal diagnosis or the actions of others from upending and even ending your life or the lives of those you love. There's nothing you can do to stop that. Try as you might, there's always something that could take it all away. And I don't tell you that to depress you or to stress you out or to cause you to fear. I tell you that in order to point you and push you toward the one thing I think can bring you peace in the context of that reality, which is that there is a good God who loves you, who is over and in it all. That's it. It could all be taken away in an instant, but there is a good God who cares, who's over and in it all. The question is, do you really believe that? The more you do, the greater your peace will be. I want you to know that in my small experience, and it is very small, I don't pretend to have had some extraordinarily difficult life. So it's a small experience, but in that small experience, I can say God has been unfailingly faithful. Even through suffering, even through difficulty, even through doubt and other trials. So I believe he will be faithful for you as well, to you as well. If you're wondering though, but how can I know that? How can I know he'll be faithful to me? Then I would draw your attention to a verse we're going to get to in a couple of weeks, which is Romans 8:32, which says this, "He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things?" So what Paul's doing here is he's just trying to get you to think logically. He's asking the rhetorical question, would God sacrifice his own son and would Jesus come and give his life for you only to turn around and forget about you or neglect you or abandon you? And of course, the rhetorical answer is, of course not. Of course he's not going to do that. If God gave Jesus for you, then there's nothing he won't do for your good. Now, that doesn't give us all the answers as to why we experience the specific suffering that we do in this life, why some of it seems to go unresolved, but it does give us a solid reason to trust that God is at work for our good, no matter the circumstances. And so we trust him as we wait and hope and groan for the renewal of creation. But we do so with patience because he has proved himself faithful in the most profound way imaginable. Which brings us to the epitome of pain from which came new life. The broken body and the spilled blood of Jesus that we're going to celebrate this morning. We remember that Christ did not leave us in our suffering, but he came and he bore our suffering with us so that he could deliver the ultimate cure for suffering, resurrection from the dead. Resurrection from the dead. And so his sacrifice purchased our hope that will not fail. So before we celebrate, let me give a few instructions. We're going to do communion like we did, similar to how we did it last month. If you have trusted Jesus as your Savior, you are invited to participate in this with us. After I pray and share some scripture, we're going to start with just the rows closest to the front. Come up and you can receive the elements here. But don't everybody feel like you've got to jump out of your seat all at once. I'm just going to ask that we go roughly a row at a time for each line. And so use that time as you're waiting to come forward just to reflect on what we're celebrating here and take some time between you and the Lord as you're waiting for the line to die down. After you receive the elements, ask that you just take them back to your seats, and then you're free to take those just in your own time. You can take them right away. You can sit and think and pray for a little bit before you take them. Just take them in your own time when you get back to your seat. And as we hand you, as the servers hand you the elements, just know we're going to give you a little reminder of what's represented here. Christ's body was broken for you. Christ's blood was shed for you. And we don't mean that to be awkward, but it is a heavy reality. It's a heavy reality that we're remembering this morning. And so don't let the awkwardness of somebody telling you that it's Christ's body broken for you and Christ's blood shed for you, don't let that distract you from the awesome reality that we're considering. If you're unsure or unable about coming up front and carrying the elements back to your seat on your own, please, we're going to have some roving servers. So just flag them down. They'd be happy to serve you. Families with kids, please take advantage of that. Those with mobility issues, anyone else who would benefit from that, just flag one of them down. And if it takes them a little bit of time to get to you, that's okay. We're in no rush here. And again, just use that time to reflect on what we're celebrating. As a note for anyone in our overflow rooms or out in the foyer, once the roving servers are done in here, they'll come back and they'll serve you as well. And then finally, after all the elements are distributed, we'll sit down and we're just going to have one song kind of at the end. Again, just a time to thank God and worship Him for what we're celebrating this morning, just to build a little bit more time to reflect on that at the end here. So, with that, let me pray for us. And as I do, I'm going to ask those who are going to be serving the elements to come forward. And then I'll share a little bit of scripture, and then we'll share in communion together. Father God, we thank you. We thank you that because you are our Father, and because you are sovereign over all, we have a hope that cannot fail. We thank you again that you turn suffering into rejoicing in the end. We thank you for that because there's a lot of suffering. There's a lot of suffering in our lives, in the lives of those around us, in our world at large. There's a lot of suffering. And so we look forward to the day when that suffering produces a glorious new creation, a glorious renewal takes place. We look forward to the day where the sons of God are revealed and where you get the glory for that. And as we celebrate and remember your sacrifice, Jesus, on our behalf, that you came, that you died for us, and that you rose for us, as we reflect on the fact that your body was broken for us, your blood was poured out for us, and that brought us new life. Would that again give us hope that you bring new life even out of death? And so would we bring our suffering to you this morning? Would we bring it to you that you might transform it into hope and give us a vision for the new life that you're going to bring out of it? So we thank you, we praise you, in Jesus' name, amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, saying, "This is my body, which is for you. Take it in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. As often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the death of the Lord until his coming again." So now, please come forward and taste and see that the Lord is good.
Is sing and let now your
forgiveness, the greatest relief.
you're invited to the table where suffering is transformed into new life. And so we worship him, and to him be the glory who came and gave himself that that might be a reality. To the one who is making all things new, to Jesus Christ, our Savior, be the glory forever and ever. Amen. You're dismissed.